I feel your frustration. I feel your frustration. So I want to address this. It's what's present right now in the world. So I've been feeling this before this video. I've gone into this sort of reverie, which I don't do very often, about frustration. And so I'm going to address this. I'm going to address your frustration about spiritual advice, spiritual helpers, life, the spiritual path. It just doesn't seem to work very well, does it? For hardly any of us, actually. Let's see if I can brighten this up. But don't worry, I will not leave you floundering, okay? I have something else even more profound to share with you here. But we will at least start out with this frustration, and it's really quite terrible. Truth be told, all the spiritual teaching throughout history doesn't really answer our questions, does it? It does not. It does not. And so if we look at it from that way, that perspective, we say, what's going on here? I could ask questions all day long about from the teacher, so you didn't address this. You're not really, what you say is not really relevant to me at all. A lot of it's bourgeois spirituality, it seems like, right? And I don't live that life at all. I'm like a slave laborer. I have been my whole life. My previous life, I was born in terrible poverty. I was forced into child labor just to keep the family alive, support them alive, and through just a grace of God, I don't know how to explain it. My talents led me to the top of the world, but I never, forgot my upbringing and the circumstances, my family, parents and brothers and sisters, and what we went through. And in this life, we were, petite bourgeois, but it fell apart, and it's been a big struggle, a terrible struggle. I feel like on the edge of destitution most of my life. But because of my previous life, where I worked myself up into, like, a hero of the bourgeois, giving them the culture they craved, I'm able to associate with that, but I never feel like I'm part of it. Because I've got my hands dirty, my feet dirty, and I know what hard work actually is. And of course, I don't, like anyone else, I don't really like it. Nobody really likes working hard, and I can relate with empathy and experience with everyone who does really tough work. And everything I see in the world, I see this pathway here. It's a concrete with pebbles, and I know my friend did that a long time ago. Long time ago, maybe 40 years ago or longer, my friend. And he ended up being homeless and derelict and so messed up. He's one of those messed up people. It's horrible. I mean, nobody even wants to see him. It's so tragic. But he did this. He did this walkway for us here. And I know how, what hard work it was, and it took a terrible toll on him. Concrete work, all this stuff. I associate with laborers. Okay, so I know all the hard work. I've done it myself. I'm friends with the people who do it. So I don't take any joy at all in this world when I go to anywhere, because I know all the work, hard work that's gone into the infrastructure that makes it so nice for the bourgeois to, to enjoy, pursue their, the bonfire of their vanities, and all the maintenance that goes into it. All the maintenance is horrible. All the painting that is continuously done everywhere, all the fixing up everything that, it just goes, it never ends. It never ends. The roads you're going on. I know, I did road work. I know how tough it is to build roads, to repair roads. It's brutal. It's brutal. The fencing, I see the guardrails. I know every single post there. I say, oh my God, and drilling all those holes and just everything. I said, oh my God, this is horrible. You know, this work. It just. I seen a guy at the jackhammer. I said, look, by the time you're 45, you won't be able to get out of bed. And he goes, oh yeah, I know. What choice do I have? So in the back of their mind, they know it, but they said, what choice do I have? I got no choice. So I don't take any joy in this world at all. Because in the back of my mind, I say, yeah, I'm seeing a nice sunset. But who put this? I mean, who made all these trails and who did these roads and who put up the lighting and who made the car and who, you know, who did all this? And you find it's all these people, these laborers who just doing it just to survive so they can eat. They pretty much they just work nor to eat to survive. And it's brutal stuff, and they don't like it. You think, oh yeah, they're happy. No, they're not. No, they're not. They just say, well, I don't have a choice do I have, you know? And they're just waiting to die, kind of. You just get a little bit of happiness. And so I'm gallivanting about, but I know I'm living off the fruits of the labor of everyone, right? Wherever you go. And I don't like it at all. I don't like to work as a laborer. It's terrible. So the spiritual teachings never address any of this. They don't address culture either, really. There's a lot they don't address. They don't address technology. They don't address culture, art, business. They don't address any of that, do they? Show me the teachers that really address all this. None of them do. None of them really do. There may be a few exceptions, but generally, like non-duality just doesn't address any of that stuff. It just says it's all unreal. So there's enormous frustration of feeling like you're not getting the answers. I've experienced that my whole life, and you have to sort of just say, wow, got to have a lot of faith in the Dharma kings and those who do the great non-dual teaching. You know, why don't they address this? There must be some reason behind it. And the guilt, I feel so guilty. You know, I'm living off of the labor of others. You know, the house, you know how difficult it is to build houses. It doesn't magically appear. You know, the people leave their house, they come back, it's done. Isn't that nice? No. I mean, the people are there sweating in the sun. How would you like to be a roofer, you know? Working your whole, I just talked to a roofer today, a friend of mine. I saw him. I said, "Hey, how you doing?" He said, "Well," he says, "Well, I've had some rough times in here and up and down." No, another roofer who's, on the verge of suicide. They don't live very long. Neither do plumbers. This is nice. We've got a nice roof over our heads. Well, who put the roof up there? You see, I get sick to my stomach. See the work the roofers do. It's brutal work. It's brutal. Few of them can handle it. One of my talk to is happy, one of the rare ones that's healthy and happy, and he's just exceptional. I've talked with him and asked him how you manage, and he's a rare bird. But he said most of them, they're either alcoholic, suicide, early deaths, very unhappy being a roofer. It's brutal work, brutal. And try doing that in a hot climate, and like in Phoenix in the summertime. I talked to guys who have labored in Mexicali and in Phoenix area, etc. And they get up, start work at 4 in the morning, but it's brutal. So we live, and so here in a nice house, but all the effort that's gone to that house, not to mention manufacturing all the materials, right? I mean, try that. So to be bourgeois, to be is to be guilty. And I know Jesus in the Course in Miracles says you're not supposed to be guilty. Well, what kind of guilt, is being talked about here? I mean, it seems like the guilt about like angry, like, well, I'm angry at somebody. Well, that's very bourgeois. I mean, lower class people can't afford to be angry. I mean, what angry? What good does that do? You got to get up in the morning and dig ditches. You got no choice. So you don't have all this, vanity stuff about, well, I'm so hurt, my someone's hurt my feelings. They said something I didn't like, and I don't like what they said. I don't like what they did or they said, and I'm upset about this. And but I feel guilty about what they, how they think about me. All this nonsense. How does that relate to my life at all? It doesn't relate to it at all, really. I'm just like worried about, am I going to be destitute or not? That's the only thing I think about, actually. I don't care about any of that personal interaction and hurt feelings and guilt and stuff like that. That doesn't even touch upon my world at all. So it doesn't really answer these questions at all. So with that being said, and you can go on and on and on, you can do a rant on all this. It doesn't do any good. I mean, I've asked spiritual help my whole life. I said, could you answer these questions? No, they never do. They never do. And I run out of time. I can't keep waiting for some answer because it's never appeared, actually. Unless you do the old, evolution of consciousness thing, and then you're into theosophy and all that. And I try that, and but that leaves a lot of questions unanswered as well. Like, why would this brutal, slog through all this stuff? Why? It doesn't, it just seems to raise even deeper questions by trying to answer the. So, on one hand, you have the what, like theosophy trying to answer this stuff. On the other hand, you have the non-dual stuff. They don't even bother answering any of it at all, actually. And it's kind of weird, isn't it? It's very weird. Okay, but, I'll throw a knuckleball into all of this. So we're not, well, I'll have to try and explain what happened. So I don't know what to do. I went on retreat like God told me to do, and it was all successful. It's like a trial run. It was brilliantly done. God fulfilled his promises to me. I was exactly where I needed to be May 22nd, exactly how God promised I would be there, and I was there. Miraculously. Okay, so it was like amazing. But now I'm back here, and I don't want to be here. I don't want to be in the Bay Area. Besides all the terribleness of it, we don't want to get nuked by North Korea. Okay, we're right where, we're in their crosshairs, so to speak. The Cold War is now, more dangerous than ever. And we've already been, I grew up in the Cold War here, with fear of the Russians nuking us. And now we're back into the Cold War. If you live in Seattle, San Francisco, or LA, San Diego area, the prime targets for the North Koreans to send a intercontinental ballistic missile over here with a nuclear warhead. And they're feverishly working on that and saying that they're going to do exactly that. And they may, if you look at what happened to, what took place in North Korea? No country's ever suffered the devastation they have. I mean, some have. I mean, Judea under the Romans raising the whole countryside, they experienced that terrible devastation. And but we carpet U.S. carpet bombed. They just North Korea devastated, absolute devastation. Dropped more bombs on North Korea than all the bombs dropped in World War II. Okay. The napalm, the amount of napalm that was dropped. They're not, too happy about that, to say the least. And they want revenge. They absolutely, they live, their whole culture from that point on has been nothing but a culture of revenge. All they think about is revenge. So, I mean, we're not sitting here very comfortable right now on the West Coast. And yeah, they shot down a test ICBM today, U.S. government. Yeah, but their success rate is 50%, basically. 50%. Yeah, half of them, they failed. So they say, well, this time it was successful. Well, yeah, great. I don't really like the, 50% odds here in the Bay Area, right? So it's a miserable time here. No one's saying anything about it here. No one's saying a word here. Although Seattle's trying to introduce, nuclear attack drills, cases, and it's blocked. It's against the law to have safety drills related to a nuclear disaster in Washington, apparently. Figure that out. So, we're kind of on the edge of desperation here, to say the least. Besides, everything that is really unpalatable about the Bay Area, which is just about everything. You add to that that we are in the crosshairs of people who think that getting their happiness will be given to them by getting revenge on the United States. Not to mention, other types of threats to the U.S., like the EMP pulse from Korea. So, it's not a good time. It's not a good time at all. So, with that background, I'm not happy to be here. I had to come back. I found a refuge. It was perfect. And then I had to come back. I said, oh, that's a trial run. But yeah, I don't know what to do. Having nightmares. All this stuff. That maybe I'm doing the wrong thing by taping. Possible, and I'm going to miss the boat. Like that. Wow. Awful stuff. And the Christians talk about rapture in early Jude, and I'm reading that, and I say, my God, if there is a rapture, I don't think any of them are going to be taken. That is for sure. I mean, they're clueless. And that just I you know it's just like, what are they talking about? They don't know the Jesus I know. That's for sure. And just the whole thing, the whole world is just awful. If you look at it for a certain way, it's just awful. And somehow we have to block it all out. We have to get into the princess complex, the bourgeois princess complex, like entitlement. Yeah, I have all stuff because I'm entitled to it. Because if you don't do that, you're gonna feel guilty. Because the clothes you're wearing are made in some sweatshop. The shoes I'm wearing are some sweatshop, right? Getting paid peanuts, just starvation wages. The technology people are using are sweatshops, people jumping out windows, committing suicide. It's like a prison labor almost. It's not pretty living in this world at all. So, with that as a grand backdrop, I was wondering, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? How can I help you? How can I help myself? How can I help you? How can I help everyone? That's all I think about. How can I be helpful? And I was trying to remember a name because it seems like every time I come across this person, something helpful happens. And I try to remember his name, and I always have trouble remembering his name. And suddenly I remembered his name, Francis Lucille. He's from Temecula, California. It's kind of south of Orange County, between Orange County and San Diego, inland a little bit. Very lovely place, very bourgeois place, to say the least. And he's a very bourgeois guy. Beautiful home, looks very affluent and everything. But he's a non-dual teacher, Francis Lucille. I believe Rupert Spira was stayed like 12 years with him or something. I mean, he has some, he's got something. Anyway, I've watched some of his videos before, and it seems like my dreams get better when I watch his videos. I can't remember if that's exactly right or not, but I just have this impression whenever I come across him, I'm blessed somehow. But I don't really resonate with his teaching entirely, really. Not entirely, but whose teaching do you resonate with entirely, right? Maybe that's a maybe that just doesn't happen actually, so much. But I resonate with some of it. It's like so. But when I go, I didn't. I've never gone to see him. It's a long drive, and the gas to go down there, the money to see him. I guess if it was like the number one thing in my life. I might be able to do it. I don't know. Maybe even not. It's up to God's grace. But I don't have the luxury of being able to do that. Somehow, that retreat that we went on, God arranged for it all. So it was quite extraordinary. Huh? Yeah, what's up?
Yeah, turn it down. Turn it down. Turn it way down. Turn it to the clockwise.
One.
Clockwise. Yeah, warm. Yeah.
One?
Yeah.
Seven.
Yeah. I'll do it later in the water heater, okay? Yeah, okay. I'll adjust it. Okay.
So there you go. Nothing's ever right. So I decided to watch. I said, let me look at YouTube. I got nothing else to do. Let me look at Frances Lucille video on YouTube. And so I did. And I'm watching it, and I say, what's wrong with him? I mean, this isn't. It was a recent one. I say, something isn't right. Something isn't right. You seem troubled. He really seemed troubled. So I said, wow. The world somehow, something's, you know, getting to him for sure. And then there's this person that is there. It's a woman who's asking him questions, and she's digging, and it's like the same old thing. Like, I'm saying, wow, this isn't it. I mean, how's he going to handle this? He's like, could you explain the mind and conscious? I'm not sure, you know, which of this. You know, they want a structure. They want an academic. They want answers, academic answers. So, okay, I know the answer now because the mind's like this and the conscious is like this and this is like this. And it's kind of like, you know, like how do I, okay, there's some instructions to how to knit this, you know, knit this potholder or something. I need the instructions. So they're trying to get an instruction. It's like you've heard 1,000 times, like in these non-dual. It's just the same thing over and over and over. And then Francis is like, it's just like going, and I could feel like he's thinking, like, what do I say, you know? And he's trying, you know, he's trying, and he's going, and so I'm seeing all this, and I just said, oh my God, it's so depressing, I don't know what to say. Can we not help anyone? Is it really this difficult? Do we have to just, you know, is this it? And suddenly, I just burst out laughing. And I just laughed, and I laughed, and I laughed, and I laughed. And the laughter was like coming from spirit. The laughter came from spirit. It was coming from spirit. It was like the laughter of Sri Sri Ananda Mahima. It's different laughter. You know, what's causing, uncausing, what's causing the laughter? Why? You couldn't answer any of those questions. It was beautiful laughter. And all I wanted to do was just laugh. You know, I wanted to laugh at the woman who's asking the question. Just laugh. But there was a whole context to the laughter, a beautiful spiritual context of grace and compassion and liberation to the laughter. And it was just laughter. That's all it was. There was no concepts. There was no answers. It was just laughter. And nothing bothered me. I just felt just beautiful laughter. That's all. And I remember Jesus telling us our entire problem is we didn't remember to laugh. We had this absurd idea, this absurd notion, and we just forgot to laugh. Well, I remembered to laugh. I remembered to laugh. And so you might say this is the most profound experience of my life. That right in the midst of this despair and it seeming just like even the gurus are stuck now and can't seem to help, and they're like, they're getting dragged down, and you know, what help is there? This is all horrible. You know, panic was right at the doorstep, and somehow my spirit remembered to laugh, and that's all it needed to hear. And you know, it's inexplicable. You know, it's really inexplicable. So we could either just flounder, or we can laugh. You know, it's one of the two. We'll never get explanations that'll satisfy us. Really, I've searched for them, and there's no way anyone's going to find it. No way. And the laughter I experienced cannot put it in a box and explain it. But you can feel it. It's so I just remembered to laugh. How absurd this is, you know, how absurd this is, how and at that point, I was the guru, you know. I was spirit. I was just in laughter, spiritual laughter. And that's what Jesus said. That's it. That resolves it all. And it was resolved. It was all resolved. All this guilt, all this everything, struggle and everything, was just dissolved in laughter. And it just came out of the blue. There was nothing preceding it. I just burst into laughter. There was nothing causing it. I just decided to laugh. I just remembered to laugh. Somehow, the grace, the resolve in me was sufficient to just laugh. And so I've reached this resolve, a level of resolve sufficient to laugh. And it's the most helpful thing there is. It's the most helpful there is. It's beyond this non-dual talk and questions and all this stuff. It's beyond all that. It's Sri Sri Nandamai Ma just sitting in silence and then just bursting into laughter. You know, someone asking her a question and she's just paying no attention to anything. And then she just bursts into laughter. And it's her laughter is the greatest thing in the world. There's some video of her, audio of her laughter. And really, that's the most precious thing there is in the world. Because it's not creature laughter. It's not creature laughter. It's sublime and beautiful. And it just takes away the world. It just takes away the world. The world disappears when you hear that laughter. And I tried make videos, and I tried everything I could do to share her laughter with the world. I said, "You just got to hear this. If you just hear this, it's going to. You'll never look at the world in the same way." Well, I now have experienced that laughter for myself, and so I know it's within us. Jesus says we've just forgotten to laugh. That's it. And he says, when you remember to laugh, that's the end of it. He says, how should all this insanity end? He says it ends with a laugh. That's it. It's not about us figuring anything out. It's not about us getting any answers. And this has happened several times to me, but this was even more profound. I was able to kind of experience it and sort of and feel it and then wow it, of course, wow it. So, this laughter is within you. It absolutely is within you, and it can emerge. It can emerge. Sometimes at the darkest times, suddenly it will emerge. Now, yeah, I have to be very careful not to try and figure out how to get it back again. Instead, what do? We wow it. Okay. So it's been my wowing of the resolve that I keep has been growing in me that has got me to this point, for sure. So we need to look at this. The laughter is essential. You simply laugh the world away. It's I can't explain it. But it's within you, and it can happen when you have enough resolve, overall resolve. And that's how does that come about? It comes about through exceeding our expectations. And then when our And then when we start to panic, we block the panic. When our expectations are exceeded, we're shocked. And then when we start trying to think about, well, how can I function? We start panicking. So, and then we try to reconstitute our expectations so we can know how to function, what to expect. And it's this issue of reconstituting our expectations that is absolutely crucial. Totally, totally crucial. It's the key to success. There's a difference between heaven and hell. What we do here to succeed and to get to heaven, to get to this laughter, this really spiritual laughter, is we intentionally reconstitute the expectations as wow, instead of fighting against reconstitution. Because when we fight against reconstituting our expectations, we're only making the panic worse. We're only making it worse. We're going to panic. We are so used to expectations that if we don't have them, if they've melted down, we are going to panic. There's no question about that. So you just have to accept this frailty, familiarity issue we have at this point. And we have to be pragmatic about it. So instead of fighting it, say, no, I don't want any expectations. I want to live spontaneously and all this kind of stuff, the nice non-dual talk. But pragmatically, it doesn't work that way at all. So when we go beyond our expectations and we have breakthroughs, which I do have every day, actually, I'm without expectations. I don't know what to expect. And so I'll start to get, I'm in shock and I start to get jittery and say, well, you know, I don't know what to do. So at that point, you have to take the all-important step for success on the spiritual path. The all-important step is that intentionally you reconstitute your expectations. You do it intentionally. Just don't hope that they won't reconstitute or hope that they will. You do it on purpose. Intentionally jump in, preempt the whole process and say, yeah, okay, I'm going to set my expectations for the future, and that is wow. My expectations are wow. And you just insist on that, and you just stick with it, and stick with it, and stick with it. Wow. My expectations are wow. My functioning is wow. My understanding is wow. My life is wow. I have expectations, and there's wow. And you consciously, intentionally rebuild your expectations. Now, this seems to be counterintuitive. We think in spiritually we're trying to let go of our expectations. But, you know, show me someone who's done that. And who stayed without any expectations. As Jesus said, very, very, very rare indeed in this world. Meaning, don't count on it. Okay. So we have to be practical about this and do what works. So intentionally reconstitute your expectations. Put that wall back up. Put it back up. But it's the wall of wow right now. It's the wall of wow. And what is wow? Well, wow is so wonderful because it's so vague. It doesn't really refer to anything or any emotion in particular. It refers to really nothing in particular. It's kind of saying like, wow, I don't really know how to express it or say it. I'm not really settled on anything in particular at all. So, but that's your wall of expectation, is I'm not going to settle on anything in particular at all. So put that wall of wow up for your expectations. Imprison yourself with the bars of wow. So you put yourself back in the jail cell of expectations, but the bars are now made of wow. They're wow bars. So this is what I have done. This is what I have done. This is my path. And I've experienced this spontaneous laughter that is just, you know, I cannot delineate or define it for you. You have to experience it for yourself. But after that, I put back the bars of wow. You know, maybe I'm depressed right now because I said, oh, I just hated to see it fade away. You know, oh yeah, for sure. But you have to be very careful because, you know, the backlash, you have to You have to put yourself back in prison so the ego calms down. Because as I was laughing at this situation with this woman who was really, she'd say, well, I don't want to do this. I don't want to make this, you know, this way and this way, this way. But I got to. And then she did. And, you know, and, you know, that's what we encounter in this world. Is I really don't want to do this, but I've got to do it. I don't want to mess things up, but I got to mess it up. I don't want to, you know, and it never stops, does it? And yet, so here I am laughing and interrupting, at least, you know, the video experience, interrupting the entire situation, the guru, the non-dual guru, the one who is trying to pin the non-dual guru down, you know, and compete with them, kind of, say, look, you're not so smart, you can't really answer what I'm talking about. I mean, it's like they're trying to say, look, you don't really have the answers, do you? You know, and he's trying to say, no, I do have, I, but what I have is, you know, and just to laugh in the face of all that, to laugh in the face of it all, and just be other than, you know, just be liberated from it in laughter, inexpressibly so, inexplicably so. It shocks the world. The other world says, what? And initially in shock, you think everything's fine. But once they start panicking, they say, well, wait a minute, this is great. I mean, laughter, everything is dissolved, but how do I function? Where are my expectations? Where do they go? Then they're going to, you know, be very demanding that you, you know, help them reconstitute their expectations. So I would say in any, and you don't see the situation dissolving in this type of laughter very often. Occasionally with Muji, for instance, you've seen where it gets close to it. I wouldn't say it's quite the same. I wouldn't quite say that. But it seems that maybe he perhaps will give benefit of the doubt. It touches upon that, and there's been times. But it doesn't happen very often, does it, in the teaching? People don't expect it. They do not expect it. What are you laughing at? You know, and so to do that, then you think, oh my gosh, you know, what's the backlash going to be? And so I put myself back in the prison, but it was the prison of wow. I said, wow, I'm not going to judge it. Can I do it? Can I not do it? Well, my expectations of doing it are wow. Okay, my expectations of not doing it are wow. So I got this very, very abstract prison where it's not happening. And I put myself in that before I started getting too frustrated and struggling, like, well, I want to hold on to this. Well, of course you want to hold on to it. But then how can you be that way in the world where you're just laughing at it, laughing at everything? People think you're crazy after. They say, well, it's wonderful, but I mean, you're well, I need answers, you know. And like I said, there aren't any answers. No one's ever given answers to the guilt, really, we feel in the world about the suffering of this world and all that good stuff. Not really. I mean, to say that it's just all our own choice. I mean, driving along a road, I didn't build a road. They asked, you know, the people that built that road, they went through hell to build that road. Where's the choice in that? What do you mean? That doesn't really fit very well. It gets, you know, just, it gets too sticky, and you try to figure stuff, it just gets too sticky. And And I believe I'm sure these gurus know this. So they don't try to answer everything. Look at Ram Maharshi, Nand Maimon. They hardly tried to answer anything. It was just their presence. It was just their presence. And their presence was like a laugh. You know, Ramana, you look at him carefully, you think he's serious, he's not, his eyes are twinkling. And it's really just this laughter. I can feel it's just this golden, silvery laughter. You know, he's just blissful and joyous and just laughing. I can feel it, I see it in him. Of course, the same with Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. That twinkle in her eye, that sparkle in her eye, I could just feel that divine laughter is there. That's all is there. They didn't bother really explaining anything. They really didn't. They just said, drop the world, forget about it, just do the practice. You know, just practice. And I always thought, like, wait a minute, you know, I mean, what about explaining and giving answers to our suffering? Well, now I see that with this laughter is, you have to get to it. And when you get to it, you can understand why you shouldn't waste any time trying to understand anything about this world and understand guilt or freedom from guilt and forgiveness and even all that stuff. Even forgiveness, you shouldn't try to figure it out. I know that's counter to A Course in Miracles, which is all about forgiveness, or it may seem to be counter to it. But Jesus had to start somewhere. And so he had to start within a certain context. Otherwise, you know, he bent down and met us where we were. Okay. But that's not necessarily where we're going to get to. As Jesus said, it all ends in this laughter. And I experienced this. And that really has nothing to do with explaining anything. It has nothing to do with answers or explaining this world or explaining suffering or anything like that, actually. So there's this gap, you know, and so you have to, what's that, another spider? What are you doing, spider? Come on over here. You have to have faith. You have to have faith. And I know it's difficult right now with looking at the future and thinking, you know, my future looks like it's hell, you know. Maybe you're looking at your future and say, you know, wow. Now, again, it's an advantage being on the hot seat here in the Bay Area. Well, how long is it going to be do they have, you know, nuclear-tipped ICBMs? I don't know. They maybe already have them. Maybe 6 months. Maybe a year. Okay, something like that. We're in a, you know, six... Now to 2 years from now, they're going to have nuclear-tipped ICBMs, North Korea. So, you know, living here in the Bay Area, we're on the hot seat. And we don't I don't like being on that hot seat. So I'm motivated. I'm really motivated. People the rest of the world, you know, they got their knockwurst and beer and, you know, go to a rave or some parade and, you know, enjoying life and the good, you know, vacations and stuff. I mean, so they don't have this sort of desperate immediacy that I have. Being desperate is a great thing. Just like, for instance, reincarnation, of course, in Miracles talks about, Jesus says, well, you know, it can be helpful and sometimes it's not so helpful, which is correct. I don't disagree with anything Jesus says. You know, it's just there's a context of who he's trying to reach, etc. Okay. You can't please everyone. You can't please everyone. But in my case, it was supremely helpful because it was a different thing. It wasn't that I believed in reincarnation, which I certainly did. I absolutely did. But I experienced all my previous lives. And when I experienced that, it scared the living daylights out of me because I realized death does not free us from anything. That I had all the habits I had from my previous life, I still had them. I wasn't liberated, death didn't liberate me from anything. And then I realized that I have to find some other liberation other than death. And so, you know, that I was so scared and motivated by this that really kickstarted my path more than anything else did. I mean, it was just turbocharged. You know, it just put the hounds of hell upon me. So it wasn't something like saying, "Oh, we have other lives, and isn't that wonderful?" Because Jesus says that could be a problem. Thinking, well, like I don't really have to work so hard this life, because I'll have others and everything. He said that could be a problem. You realize that all life is right now. And so he's looking at that. He was at least talking about that angle, trying to reach some from that perspective. But for me, a totally different perspective. I mean, that's the worst thing imaginable. I have other lives coming back to this world. I mean, that's just like, to me, it's unthinkable. So it just absolutely terrified me, which was a great thing, because that from that point on, I've never stopped for a minute trying to get free of getting a return ticket here. So it was supremely helpful. But that's not brought up anywhere. I've never heard anyone, hardly ever, well, the Tibetan Buddhists do. They talk about that. They said, you want, you know, not in my mind, they said, you want a return ticket here? And Tibetan Buddhist says, you want, you know, if you don't get liberty, you're going to come back here. You know that? And then they scare the heck out of you that way. And so I find that very, very helpful. I mean, you know, you think of California, we're living here like one of the most desirable places in the world here. And you think we're living the life of Riley here. It's been exactly opposite of that. It's been absolute hell. Again, growing up in the Cold War, where we did back then, we had air raid drills that they think they're going to drop a nuclear bomb, the Russians, on us in the Bay Area here. And people were supposed to, you know, have bomb shelters and how to stock up and how to survive a nuclear attack and stuff. And basically, they said hiding on your desk in the classroom is the answer. So I grew up terrified of this. Very nervous about it. And of course, the Cuban Missile Crisis in 63, we're on the brink of a nuclear war. And, you know, the end of the world. And so I grew up with the fear that, you know, that the world was going to end. And in that way. So, and then everything just continued to go wrong in every which way imaginable. So it's been a completely wretched life here, even though living in what people might say, some people say it's the best place in the world. Completely wretched. So you cannot trust in this world where you think you're going to a nice place. You cannot trust in that at all. Not at all. So that, you know, that is terrifying as well, right? I mean, there's nothing more terrifying than being in the best place in the world and being absolutely wretched. Where do you turn then? I say, well, you know, going somewhere else, that's not going to do you any good at all, is it? So it doesn't matter where you go. Dying doesn't free you. Going to some other place doesn't free you. None of this stuff does anything at all to save you from misfortune, from tragedy, from fear of destitution and want and scarcity and running into bad people and troubles and feeling guilty about, you know, having, you know, gardeners take care of everyone's yard and stuff and people paving the roads and, you know, the whole hell of this world and the vulnerability to getting hurt, getting sick. I've got friends dying all over the place right now. They're desperately struggling to not die. It doesn't take away any, you know, getting harassed at school, right? Getting bullied at school, not having the right friends, not having enough money to hang out with the right crowd, you know, being laughed at, not your sensibilities not matching up with, feeling a fish out of water, you know. It's never ending, the kind of trauma, psychological, physical, all these traumas that we can experience here. And then finding out that death doesn't free you from that at all. And that being in the nicest place in the world doesn't free you from any of that stuff at all. mean, I've been around people who have so much money and have like some of the most, you know, I can't exactly explain specifically, but let's just say, you know, I just, you know, I just turned Xanadu basically, and you know, someone living in a situation that a Roman emperor would be envious of, and are they happy? No. Does it keep them from dying and struggling with everything? No. Right. So, there's nothing you could do in this world that's really going to make you happy. Even dying is not going to make you happy. It's not going to resolve your problems. But this laughter that I experience most definitely is not troubled with any of that. It's like a different identity, you might say. You know, it's like it's a spiritual identity rather than creature identity. So the problems of creature identity will never be solved. Will never be solved at all. But they don't need to be solved. So you see these people going to these non-dual teachers, and what they're really saying is, look, hey, I want my creature problem solved. So what are you saying about consciousness? You know, I want my cake and eat it too. I insist that I am a creature, but you say there's some way to be happy? Well, explain it to me. And the teacher will say, well, you're not your body. He said, well, you know, but I'm still a creature. I don't know, you know. I may not be my body, but I'm still a creature. I'm a human being after all. No, you're not. No, you're not a human being. What are you talking about? You know? And so, but we this laughter is really the most precious value there is in this world. It's laughter not of this world. Laughter does not come from this world. It is not of this world. And where it comes from, I cannot say. I cannot say. Maybe it comes from everywhere. Or nowhere. But we can't say this, but we just can't say. And so it doesn't resolve creatureness at all. It doesn't resolve anything. It's just the laughter of freedom that I don't have a problem. I've never had a problem. There's nothing that needs to be resolved. There's nothing that needs to be answered. And so this is just a like a flipping of the switch. You flip the switch and the light goes on in the room. I mean, suddenly, you know, all the problems of living in darkness are gone. They're just gone. And where do they go? I don't know. Where does the darkness go when you turn on the light? And what is the light? Yeah, really. Those are creature questions, right? So, you can't manufacture this laughter. You cannot. You can't be the laughing yoga and ho 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 ha 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 he 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 ha 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 ha. You know, laughter yoga. You know, it's fun. I've done a bunch of that. Just myself and just, you know, it's fun. You know, ha 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 ha. Yeah, it is a nice stress reducer. Okay, but we're not talking about that kind of laughter at all. This laughter is like the laughter of compassion and love and freedom. And it transforms the situation, completely flips it inside out somehow. You know, and it's just when you get it, you hear it, you just a smile comes to you, and somehow a remembrance dawns upon you. A remembrance dawns upon you. An unspeakable remembrance. Unspeakable, undefinable, inexpressible remembrance. Just laughter, just laughter. When spirit remembers what it is, does it say, "Oh, okay, I know what it is. I'm this and this and that." No, it just laughs. It just laughs. It just laughs. It just laughs. There's no definition to what we are. There's no structure to what we are. This billionaire that with an estate that would make Caesar envious. I'm saying I wouldn't trade my life with his at all, not even remotely. You know, I've heard the laughter of Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. Okay. So this entire estate is to be is nothing, is nothing. But a burden. It's nothing but a burden. Just give me that laughter. Okay? You can take the world, as Christians, some Christians would say, take the world, but give me Jesus. But this is so seemingly elusive, isn't it? You cannot define it. You can't make it happen. You can't define it. But it will happen for you. It will happen if you practice in the wow practice way of intentionally reconstituting your expectations instead of trying to live without them, because you're not ready to live without expectations, and you may never reach that point here in this world, in this lifetime. Jesus says very, very few do. Very, very few do. That's true. Look at history. Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma was one of them, right? Ramaharshi was one of those. Very, very rare indeed. So in the meantime, don't wait around hoping, practice melting your expectations down and then intentionally reconstitute those with wow. And this provides a more and more resolve is able to be brought to bear, and you'll be able to flip the script from time to time into this laughter. It's happened a number of times with me. This was the best, most profound for sure, because I felt I could laugh in such a situation. There's this non-dual teacher, and there's someone's coming to see them, and they're intensely trying to explain what is consciousness, what am I talking about here, and how does that relate to the mind, and blah, 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 blah. And I was just able to just be liberated from the whole issue in laughter. There was no issue for me. There's no issue about consciousness and mind and spirit and definition, how is it, none of that mattered at all. Didn't matter at all. The whole issue just vanished. The whole situation just vanished. And changed, completely changed into just something unspeakable, unspeakably profound and compassionate. Into just presence, you might say, just dissolved into presence. And I said, ah, Ram Maharshi, yeah. Just the presence, right? How we long for that. How we long for that. So it can happen. It can happen. So don't give up. Don't give up. Don't give up. So I'm saying, Holy Spirit, what do I do next? I don't know. It's so up in the air. It's just like, wow. I have so many restrictions upon myself. It's unbelievable right now. I basically can't do anything at all. The Holy Spirit doesn't want me to do anything. No video, no pictures, no this, no that. But in anything I do, I feel like maybe that's getting in the way. But I just have to trust that somehow the resolve is building up here. Somehow the resolve is building up. I was listening to Chopin again, the Polish composer who basically wrote just for the piano, wrote a few pieces with the cello and wrote two piano concertos with symphony, only two. And I'm listening to the second one again in F minor. I just synchronicity had me hear it in a car, and I said, hey, wait a minute, I want to hear this. What is this? And I you know, it's been a while since I have even paid any attention to classical music or Chopin. And even though he was a contemporary, or somewhat of a contemporary of mine in Europe, we didn't really cross paths for some reason. But I looked up on Google, do you know, Chopin, and what do people think about it? And basically said, you know, he was, without question, one of the greatest composers for piano ever. What they're really saying is, you know, he may be the best ever. And they also say he was like a one-off. He was an anomaly. He was an anomaly. And looking back now, you have to say, yeah. And sometimes you don't know what you got till it's gone. And fortunately, we have the music that's being, you know, it's being played, and some people appreciate it, but. So I'm listening to it tonight. I listened to it again. And I say, yeah, it is. It's unique. It's unique. You know, how did he come up with this? I don't know. It's really something. And I'm like, wow. Just writing out the notes, the script, scripting that music is. It's quite difficult to get all the spacing and the timing right so other people can you know, play it. I mean, that's just incredibly difficult. And he is prolific, 230 pieces for piano. I didn't live very old at all. I don't know, what was he, 37, 47? He was very young when he passed away, really. He was sickly for most of his life. So these anomalies pop up. And it just, there's just something to it, right? And so sometimes spiritual teachers, there's some spiritual teachers, but it's just, they're like an anomaly. It's just, there's something to it that's just. And it happens. It happens here. It may not, not everyone's cup of tea, all right? There's different styles. And maybe Chopin's not everyone's cup of tea, etc. They're right, that's fine. But listening to it, it is different. It's different. I can just hear it. My sensibilities, musical sensibilities were just, you know, extremely rarefied because of my history. And when I was young, I could hear symphonies in my head. The whole thing could be going on. I was just composing symphonies, and I was hearing it in my mind as a child. And even if I paid attention to other stuff, the symphony was still going on. And it's very interesting. I read that Arthur Rubinstein, the great Polish pianist, who's maybe the best Chopinist there is as far as playing his music, he had the same situation when he was young. He said he could hear symphonies and musical pieces, and even though it was interrupted and he was doing things, later on in the day, he'd go back and it would be, the whole symphony was still playing in his mind. And that's exactly the experience I had. Same experiencing like that. The music was just going on in my mind constantly, which really became a problem for me. I've been trying to stop it, you know, because I want to focus on the spiritual path. But when you hear something that's just really, you know, an anomaly as far as the quality, you know, I can tell. I just know this. Wow. This is not your garden variety of piano piece. You know, this is really something that is quite out of the ordinary in terms of outstanding. So you get someone like Ram Maharshi, you know, you just know he's just out of the ordinary, outstanding. I mean, there's lots of gurus, but you know, he's a standout. Sri Sri Nandamayama, she's a standout. You know, you just don't get that very often at all. As Jesus says, very, very rare for anyone to be here without any expectations at all, living absolutely spontaneously in the now. You know, that is very rare. But we've had a couple. One in my lifetime, Sri Sri Anandamayi for sure. And then just before my lifetime, Ram Maharshi for sure. And that they even stand out from the great gurus. You know, they even stand out from the real top ones in some way. It's just, we're being benefited from them. They're immensely beneficial to us. And how do they teach? Silence, presence. But it was a silence that was full of laughter. You'd feel like, but it's not creature laughter, okay? It's not creature laughter. And in that situation, you don't really feel like asking questions. You don't really feel like trying to understand or explain anything. Like the burden is lifted off of you. The burden of understanding is somehow lifted off of you. There's no more burden of understanding. You realize it's okay. There's nothing to understand, actually. There's nothing to understand. There's no thingness to understand. There's no creatureness to understand. So, you're free of understanding. There's nothing to understand. And so they're able to lift that burden off of us. Fortunate indeed are those who come across such rare birds. So, I'm not envious of the Emperor of Rome at all. I have pity. I pity them. You know, they had wisdom, and some of them did. They'd trade their kingdom just to sit in the presence of such a one, just for a little while. You know, they realize that that's way more valuable than my kingdom. Way more valuable than to realize I don't even have to understand anything about any kingdom, or power, or principality, or anything like that. I don't have to understand anything. I don't need to do anything. I don't need to understand anything. That's what's really valuable, is to come across someone who lifts you up into that. We should never wish harm upon anyone. You know, We should always wish that everybody be lifted up, and those that are up, that they always stay up and never get pulled down, because they're the ones that help lift us up. Tiger Woods is having a problem now. They're trying to get to the bottom of it. He's someone that lifted a lot of people up. So I hate to see him be pulled down like this. You know, that just goes against my grain entirely. Anyone who's really reached the top in some way and help inspire and lift up so many, I never like want to see them get pulled down. We need them to stay. So, you know, we need as much light as we can here. And he just made golf look so easy, you know. And when you see something that's just made to look so easy, you feel somehow that connects you with your spirit, and you say, you know, it really is all so easy, actually. I'm just pretending to struggle. Really, there's no struggle in me. There's something spiritual about it. Kelly Slater, the great surfer, you know, fortunately he hasn't been pulled down. He's still, you know, doing great. And I was watching some of his surfing at Cloud Break in Fiji. And actually that contest is going to start June 4th. The women's already started, and men's started June 4th. And he says that's his favorite wave in all the world. And I watched this video and of one of the years, the contest years, I remember which year it was, 2010 or 2012 or 14 or something. But and he was saying that, in his opinion, these are the greatest waves that the planet has ever seen, that no one's ever surfed or seen waves this great in history. That's how great that was breaking that day. And it showed all this video, and it was just, you know, mind-blowing, to say the least. I've never seen anything like it, the waves. They're lefts, and the tubes, and the length of the tube, and you know, it beats Pipeline and Chapu. You know, it's the greatest wave on the planet. That's what he was saying. And then it showed some of his, I guess, him surfing where he won the contest, and the waves, and just, you know, you just could hardly believe it. And how he's able to make surfing look so elegant and beautiful and smooth and everything, how he does it. Yeah, you just have to say thank you, you know, because it's spiritual to see that. There's something there. There's something that elevates us to say, wait a minute. That's me out there surfing, you know. That's me. That's me. Tiger Woods, I say, that's me playing golf. It really is me. I'm just pretending to be an idiot, you know, but that's really what I am there. I can do that. There's no doubt about it. I can surf like Kelly Slater. I know I can. And he's just showing me, yeah. You know. You can surf like this. You can surf like this. So I don't get envious. I don't wish, criticize them or anything. I say, no, give me more. Give me more of this. Give me more of this. And then John Florence at Cloud Break got on this wave at 19 years old. So that been 5 years ago. So it'd be 2012. Might have been 2012. This the great swell there. And he gets in this massive wave, so deep. And he just takes this line. He's just standing tall, relaxed, like he's just cruising at Waikiki. And he's just being barreled by this mass. And the whole time, he just keeps this perfect line through the whole thing. And it's just like, oh, it's just like a stroll in the park, you know. And just to see that, it's like, you know, someone said, look, no worries. No worries. This, you know, the world is throwing this monster at me. And no worries at all. I'm just taking the exactly right line in there. There's no troubles at all here. And Slater saw that, said, look at that line. He just took the perfect line there, and he's just holding this perfect line. It was so artistically done. It reminds me of Jerry Lopez at Pipeline, how he used to do that, how he would just make surfing look like ballet or so easy, or just he's so relaxed. He's at one with everything. There's no trouble at all. The ocean is just his friend. It's not there to hurt him. And so the ocean's just saying, "Here, Jerry, I'm just going to give you this beautiful experience, and you just relax on the surfboard, and just I'll just bring it, cruise you through this." And it's like that. It's just like there's no trouble here. Jerry Lopez is a very spiritual guy. He's a very dharmic brother. He's a brother who's very dharmic, actually. And you know, back in the day, surfers were kind of like dharma bums. Some of them. Not quite that way these days. For cultures, this is what it is. John Severance on the star of Surfer Magazine just passed away. I remember when it first came out, Surfer Magazine. I grew up with Surfer Magazine, and I remember getting it, going to the newsstand, and the 7-Eleven, Speedy 7-Eleven, and getting Surfer and just looking at all these pictures. Just, oh my God, I can't believe it. All these places around the world we've never seen before, and so. Seeing all that, I said, oh my gosh, people can ride these waves, that's amazing. So you never want to see, your heroes, those who lift you up, inspire you to say, you know what? It really is easy. Okay, it can be easy. You don't want to see them pulled down. So, all prayers to Tiger Woods, he had some sort of reaction to painkillers, some medication. He wasn't on alcohol. His breath was 0-0-0, but he didn't look good at all. So, all prayers to Tiger Woods to find that laughter, to find that laughter. All prayers to all of us, okay, to find that laughter, to gather our resolve. So that laughter, and we experience that laughter. And we realize there's nothing to figure out. There's nothing difficult at all for us. There's nothing we need to answer to. There are no questions. We're unquestionable. We're unquestionable. We're totally unquestionable. All of us. Totally unquestionable. We're totally unquestionable. This is what needs to be conveyed. We're totally unquestionable. This is what needs to be conveyed. And the great gurus, the Dharma kings, they do that. They do that. They convey that. Sri Sri Nandamayi Maharaj, look, she's looking at you, and she sees you. You're totally unquestionable what you are. It's just absurd to question what you are. And so I'm just laughing. I'm just laughing and helping you realize that it's just completely absurd. It's totally absurd. Ram Maharshi looking at us and just reassuring us, you're unquestionable, you're unquestionable. There's no questions that can ever be raised. There are no questions at all. There are no questions at all, actually. So struggling to give answers, what's the point? It just reinforces the notion there are questions. So what these great gurus are really getting at is that they have faith in us, we can get to this and realize there's no question. We're unquestionable. Reality is unquestionable. There are no questions. There's no questionability at all. We can get to this. And they're just reminding us. They have faith that the spell will be broken for us. It's a spell we're under. We put ourselves under a spell. A spell of questionability. We're unquestionable. So, for me, Tiger Woods is unquestionable. Everyone's unquestionable, You know, he's stainless. He's stainless. He's not stained. Now, people say that he's fallen. What a tragic story. No, he hasn't. In my eyes, he hasn't fallen at all. Okay, and people need to hear that. This is just an example I'm using. But the gurus, in their eyes, you haven't fallen at all. Everyone, they see everyone this way. You haven't fallen at all. You're their hero, so to speak. I mean, you're a shining light to them. You haven't fallen at all. There's no stain upon you. You're still unquestionable. Absolutely unquestionable. So I'm just using this as an example. For me, Tiger Woods has never been stained at all. He's never been stained. People say that this scandal, this and you know this and all this piling. They're piling on all this stuff. He's so stained. He's ruined. You know, no, he's the same as always been. In my eyes, he hasn't been stained in the slightest bit. I look right past all of that. So we can do that for everyone, and even more than that, is look right past all of that stuff. In everyone's life, no light, no human creature belief has stained us at all. This is all. So it's a wonderful example. I can see that in one person that, you know, he's not stained. You know, he's still this golfing god who just thrilled us all, golfers, just thrilled us all. And we were just a captive audience, and we were just saying, oh my gosh, you know, and he's out there laughing and just like having fun and saying, wow, this is fun. and he's saying, you know, how is he doing this? What is he doing? And he just seems to, the golf course just seems to do whatever he wants it to do for him. And we say, yeah, in my dreams, that's what I do. And so he was like a dream golfer. He was drug golfing the way we golf in our dreams, our daydreams. And I still do. I golf that way in my daydreams, even better. And I don't want to actually play golf because that interrupts my daydreams of my golf game, which is like, you know, flawless. In my daydreams, it's flawless. I can dream it where I birdie every single hole and I can do no wrong. So why should I even play golf? Don't want to ruin it. But he actually literally played the way we daydream. So I say, wait a minute. Maybe our daydreams really can be real. You see, maybe we're better than we realize. Maybe we're stainless. You see, he was like stainless. Nothing golf course couldn't get to him, really. Even when it seemed to get to him, he always had a way to bounce back and turn the tables and flip the script on everything. He flipped the script on golf, completely flipped it, the script, and blew everybody's minds, including all the professional golfers. He blew their minds. Yeah. So, you know, Jack Nicklaus said, hey, Tiger Woods needs our help. Well, he needs our prayers. He needs to hear that he's still stainless in our eyes. Okay, he hasn't fallen at all. And there's nothing to forgive him for. I don't need to forgive him for anything. He hasn't fallen. So what's to forgive? There's nothing to forgive. He's still the guy. He's still the guy. Always will be. But we can look at everyone that way. You know, we are all still spirit, and we always will be. Every single one of us. The gurus are able to see every single one of us that way. So God bless the gurus, that is for sure. And we're struggling, but if you can see one that way, Jesus says, it helps you see everyone that way. But I really feel that way with Tiger Woods. I really feel that way. You know, it's genuine. And he stopped. He was going through a crowd, the President's Cup. Oh, no, it was WC. Was it the President's Cup? Yeah, I believe it was. Or was it World Golf Championship? Maybe it was a World Golf Championship event. Harding Park, San Francisco. And there was huge crowds. And he was walking to the clubhouse or something. He was very aloof on the golf course because he's so focused. And there were, you know, thousands of people lining both sides of the barricades and everything. And he was walking. I saw him from a distance. And he's walking. He's in the middle of this whole, and he's not stopping for anyone. He's got tunnel vision. And I'm saying, oh, wow, you know, I don't have a chance. You know, I'd really like to just, you know, say thank you, Tiger, for everything you've done. You know, just to keep me going in life and make me feel, you know, maybe our dreams can come true or something. Maybe we can flip the script on this world, you know. And as he's walking, so I don't know how it even happened. I sort of reached out, I had my scorecard over the barricade, and I was like, and he just starts walking right towards me, and he comes right over towards me, and he smiles right at me. He says, "How you doing? Hi, hi," and takes my scorecard, and I said, "Wow, thanks, Tiger." And he signed my scorecard. He signed my scorecard, and then he gave it back to me, and smiled, and kept on walking, and didn't sign anybody else's, you know. And so I never forgot that. I never forgot. I said, "Wow." I said, "Maybe someday, you know, I'm gonna sign. I'll let you sign my scorecard." You know? So sometimes there's a little act of grace, of kindness, something, you know, that some for the right situation that someone never forgets. And he, you know, he didn't know whose scorecard he was signing. He didn't know who it was that he went over there to, you know. But it was someone with connections to the Dharma Kings, and someone that has resolved to remember to laugh. You see, he signed that one scorecard. Pretty amazing, huh? And so now he's, you know, the world, he's the whipping boy of the world right now. But he's got a friend here. He's got a friend here. And he's done a lot of kindness for so many people, you know? So many people. And so, you know, we're not pleased at all that the world is deciding that he's going to, you know, they decide, oh, we've got a whipping boy, make ourselves feel better. We can't rise up, so let's pull somebody down, you know, pull somebody down to where we're at. And, you know, misery loves company. And it's a brutal thing, you know, it's a brutal thing here. So, God bless Jack Nicholas for standing up for him and saying, you know, he needs our help. You know, he doesn't need our condemnation, he needs our help. But I say even better than that, he doesn't need our help. He's never done, he's never fallen in my eyes at all. But it's easy to say, you know, for me, but for him, of course, you know, you get everybody thinking that you've failed them or something. You know, that's too heavy a burden to carry. So, you know, when you're on top, it's tough. Michael Jackson, you know, trying to stay on top. He was trying to entertain the world and trying to give them something that raised our spirits in some way. And it was just brutal for him. It was just brutal. He was so full of flow, you know. He's so full of flow, and he was trying to convey that flow, and you know, it ate him alive. The world ate him alive, and he couldn't sleep anymore. Heavy the head that wears the crown in this world, to say the least. And we have to be appreciative of all those who set some sort of standard where it just seems like, you know what, this really isn't a physical material world at all. It's all spiritual. It's all spiritual, actually. And the world's really not on top of us, actually. You know, we're not really buried. We're not really buried. So many of us feel we're buried, right? And you get occasionally get someone come along, and they're not buried. You know, they're saying, "Hey, look, I'm not buried, and you're not either." And we have to appreciate that, and understand that the weight on them is really brutal. Really brutal. And so we have to have their backs. You know, we have to have their backs. And I had to get rid of all my Tiger Woods gear, you know, because we couldn't wear it anymore on the golf course and stuff. I have a hat now that I wore recently, and so, but you know, it makes it tough because you know, people look at you like, you're not still supporting that idiot, huh? I mean, you gotta get so many negative comments. Yeah, he's done. What a jerk, you know, and all this stuff. It's like, are you kidding me? How easy people turn on someone, right? But then other people say, you know, say no. I wish them the best. You know, I hate to see this. You know, so there's kind of a division in the world between those two camps. Yeah, I think most of us, you know, if we could, we would really say, you know what? No, I don't. We don't wish ill upon anyone. We don't want wish, you know, a fall upon anyone. Because really, they are us. You know, they are us. We're all the same. We're all one spirit. We're all the spirit. We're all spirit, and we're all struggling to laugh and realize, you know, nothing's ever happened. We're unquestionable. We can do no wrong. We can do no wrong, actually, at all. None of us can do any wrong. We're stainless, completely stainless. You know, you screw your back up trying to entertain people by swinging so hard. Four back surgeries, you know, spinal fusion now, terrible pain, constant horrible pain. Got addicted apparently to painkillers. I mean, the last surgery, the spinal fusion, he said he woke up, he didn't have any more pain. But then he said he had this interaction with his medication, prescription medications. You got to believe they're probably painkillers. He may be addicted to painkillers, actually. That's very possible. He's probably been on painkillers for many years right now. And that's not a joke. They said the police found him. He was asleep in his car. His car was running. Both tires on the driver's side were flat. The front and rear bumpers were smashed up. And they asked him where he was. And he said he thought he was driving from, you know, in Orange County, Los Angeles, to his home in Orange County, Los Angeles, where he was in Jupiter, Florida. He didn't know where he was. This sounds to me like he may have an addiction to painkillers. And he mixed some medication with the pain, powerful, maybe, you know, OxyContin or, you know, something like that, you know, strong painkiller. You know, that's, you know, bad. That's not good at all. So, you know, that can happen when you have a bad back. I understand. When you have constant pain like that, it wears you out, wears you down. You can't do what you love. It's brutal. It's absolutely brutal. So how about everybody, you know, wishing, more than wishing, but affirming, you know, hey, nobody has fallen in my eyes at all. Nobody can fall in my eyes. Nobody can fall. I know there may be a few that you think are tough. So don't think about those. Okay. Don't think about those. You can probably think of one person. Okay. I know Jesus says you can't make a single exception. But, you know, as soon as you start focusing on that one tough person, it throws you off. Okay. So don't think about them. Don't think about them. Think about, you know, for me, I could think like it, just virtually nobody do I really want to. Everyone's stainless. And I'm not going to think about, you know, maybe the exception. That ruins it. We need to get used to this. And eventually I'll be able to generalize to that exception. But why put the most difficult one in front of your face to start with when you're trying to get used to doing this? I mean, you know, leave that out of the picture. Just be smart about it. don't wish troubles or ills or struggles upon anyone. And in fact, in your mind, they're stainless. You know, they can do no wrong. They can do no wrong. Look at it that way, that there's no one at all that can do any wrong. All of us, without exception, can do no wrong. Without exception, we can do no wrong. Okay, without any, not a single exception, we can do no wrong. And hold that feeling, focus. Hold that focus. You don't have to think of it as a feeling or a thought or anything in particular, but it's your determination, your resolve. Hold that resolve. It's resolve that turns the tide for you. This is what I've experienced. It's not a thought. It's not a feeling. It's your resolve. Hold your resolve, which your attention tends to go along with that. It's just a resolve that this. I resolve that. There's without exception. We can do no wrong. We can do no wrong. And not, there's not even one exception to that. And hold that resolve. And we don't have to worry about consciousness and mind and stuff like that, okay? Because we can just hold our resolve that we can do no wrong. There's not one of us that can ever do wrong. Not one of us. There's not one of us that can ever stray at all. And none of us have ever strayed. We're all spotless. We're all stainless. And not one of us can ever do any wrong whatsoever. That's a fact. And so just hold on to this fact. Resolve to, this is your resolve. This is your truth. Okay, and then wow this. And then reconstitute your expectations after shocking yourself this way by saying, and my expectations about this are wow. Don't try to do without expectations. That's too much of a, too difficult. And what will happen is that will open the door to for the continuity fear, for panic, to start slamming you and pulling you down. Okay. Back into thinking otherwise, what you just thought, that the resolve was that, without exception, none of us can do any wrong at all, that's your resolve, and when the panic sets in, it will try to pull you down away from that. So instead of allowing that to happen, just say, well, I'm pulled away from it just by wow, okay? So I am pulled away from it, but what's pulling me away? Wow is pulling me away from it, okay? So pull yourself away from it on purpose. So you don't have this blame going on, like, why, you know, blaming yourself, like, how come I lost it, you know, what's stupid? I said, no, I know why I lost it, because I pulled myself away, and so I said, wow, pulled me away from it. But wow is so abstract, it feels like, well, that's not such a bad pullback, so I'm not going to get angry at myself. So you block anger at yourself, you block panic, you block self-hatred, you block frustration, you block anger, you block all of that by pulling yourself away by wow. Okay, wow, I pull myself away by the wow. Okay, fine. Not so bad. Very mild. Just do that. Just pull yourself away on purpose. And I know you want to indulge it. Oh, I got this great insight. I got this great resolve. But after you start feeling the shock of it, jump in and throw up an intentional retreat from it. Retreat to the wow. You retreat it back in your prison cell, so you're not feeling it anymore so much, your resolve. You stop the resolve on purpose. But that short circuits any other anything else pulling you away from it. You see, so you're only pulled away from it from the wow, not through any convoluted process, you know, of thinking and gradually sinking down into a bog and swamp. You know how that goes. You have a peak experience and you try to hold on to it, and gradually it unravels, and you get frustrated and you're struggling to get it back, and then you're having this internal dialogue and arguing with some part of you seems to be against it, and you're for it, and you're battling, and before you know it, you're like suicidal, you know? Really. So this way, you don't get to any of that at all. Just say, I know why I stopped. I know what happened. I just retreated to the wow. That's it. That's it. 1 second here. I'll be there. Okay. Yeah. So, yeah. Intentionally do this. This is the genius stroke that the Holy Spirit has given me. And when you do it, you just say, oh my God, you know, this is amazing. I can do this. I mean, I can intentionally break away from my spiritual resolve and throw up a defense against it like this. I can do that on purpose and yet not get angry about it. It is amazing. I thought I had to struggle and hold on, fight and go into this fight and try to hold on to it and then you know, go through all this struggle, and I lost it, and I thought that I had to do that. No, you don't need to do any of that at all. You don't need to do any of that. Your path can be smooth and easy. You have a breakthrough. You get your resolve. You gather your resolve. You have a breakthrough. You're shocked. You jump in and break your resolve. By the wow, okay, and those are your expectations. It was, wow, I'm back, and now wow, the resolve's not there. Now I'm resolving just a wow. And there's no hatred, there's no anger, there's no frustration, there's no struggle, and you just say, yeah, okay, this is nice and smooth. That's good. That works for me. And then you gather resolve again and have another breakthrough, and then you then break into that, break away from that into the wow, and then you smooth out, and then you have gather resolve, have another breakthrough. That's how it works. That's how my path is, for the most part. You have to do it, right? I mean, it's easier said than done, because sometimes you have a breakthroughs and you say, oh my gosh, I just got to hold on to this. Are you kidding me? Don't let that happen, you know, intentionally. So you don't want to interfere with it, but it's wise to, when you feel the shock, to just say, wow, okay, I'm going to jump in and imprison myself again, intentionally. So you'll feel your freedom and then intentionally put yourself back in prison. And you may seem to be, oh, can I do that? Yes, you can. Yes, you can. Will God hate me? No. God's given this practice out, the wow practice, because it works. It works so beautifully. God is very, Holy Spirit is very pragmatic, understands that by doing this, you smooth everything out, and that you'll get back to, you'll gather your resolve again much quicker. Whereas if you're beating yourself up and struggling, why did I lose this previous experience? You might go weeks and weeks and not, you know, get back to it. Whereas now, I can get back to gather my resolve very quickly, very, very quickly. That's why I keep making so much progress and having so many breakthroughs, is I'm able to gather my resolve. You know, almost every day I'm able to gather it. Whereas before, you know, you live like, maybe I can gather my resolve once in my lifetime. You know, wouldn't that be great? And I gather it a few times. So that's amazing. I'm having an amazing life. I've had a couple of times where I was able to really gather my resolve. And you think you're fortunate, but you know, really, you know, if you practice this way, you can gather your resolve almost every day. Almost every day. And sometimes number of times during the day. And it's all smooth. It's all smooth. The raggedness is gone. It's just, we don't realize we can do this. We think, well, it's sacrilege. I got to try to hold on to that resolve and the breakthrough, and I don't dare. No. That automatically puts us into shock because our expectations are in tatters. And when we start trying to think about, okay, well, my breakthrough was great, but how do I, you know, chop wood and carry water? Okay, what do I do? How do I? You start panicking. So you know that, you anticipate it, you co-opt it, you jump in, say, I'm putting myself back in prison myself. I'm not waiting on panic to do it for me. I'm doing it without any panic. I'll do it very calmly, very intelligently. I'm going back into the prison of wow. And I'm just going to function in a wow way, which means kind of not trying to resolve or explain or do anything in particular to resolve, explain, whatever. I'm just pretty neutral. I'm just staying kind of neutral. I'm just kind of gliding, you know, neutral. Not trying to make anything of my life one way or the other. Not trying to have any breakthroughs at all. Not trying to really do anything in particular at all. So you function just basically, and you're not trying to improve or impress or do anything at all to make it better or worse or anything. You're just in the wow, just in a neutral kind of wow. And so then you don't struggle. And then when you don't struggle, you're either able to gather your resolve again from the confidence you got from the breakthroughs previously, and then make another big push, which is even better. So to really succeed, you need this genius on the path. You need to be a genius. You need to smooth your path out so you can gather your resolve more and more and more and more and more. And I know people think, oh, well, somebody's just naturally good at it, or, you know, whether, you know, they're just meant to be, they're an anomaly, or I can't do that. Not true at all. I was not a natural. I've just, through just sheer suffering and struggle, have been able to finally come upon this and recognize it and work at it and do it in desperation and all that. It wasn't just luck. It's not luck that I was able to gather my resolve. It's absolutely because of practicing in this way, and for no other reason. For no other reason. Because when I don't practice this way, I'm lost and forsaken. And I'm floundering just like anyone else. But when I do practice this way, I'm gathering my resolve and having tremendous breakthroughs. So it's a matter of practicing in the right way. It's not luck. It's not natural talent. It's not anything but just dogged persistence and steady determination and knowing how to practice in the right way. As Chopin said, the whole key was just holding your arms in the right place. That's what he said. He said, I just put my hand and the fingers in the right place, and it's easy for me. Well, you know, I mean, he was probably telling us the truth. It's just maybe we didn't, nobody believed him. I don't know. Maybe Rubinstein figured it out how to do that. I don't know. But in this case, with the spiritual path, it is absolutely true that by intentionally pulling yourself out of that resolve that you have, at some point you realize, well, I'm going to start to lose it. Before you lose it, jump in, say, okay, I'm intentionally pulling myself away now into the wow. And so the whole thing is very conscious, no struggle, it's smooth. And, you know, you might have a pang of like, maybe I should have just held on a little longer. Maybe I would have had that great breakthrough if I just, you know, so there's a little bit of that. So it takes a lot of nerve and faith and trust to do this, to short circuit the thing. But do it, do it, do it, do it, do it, do it. And the first time you do it, you'd be amazed. You'd say, oh my God, I can do this. I didn't know I could do this. And yeah, I feel like it wasn't so bad, and I feel smoothed out, and I'm not struggling. This is amazing. This is like I found the Rosetta Stone. I found the Holy Grail of the spiritual path. Yeah, it's really, it's just like that. And you'll say, well, that was easy. That was easy. That was easy. And it works. But you'll never know how easy it is and that it works until you try it. You'll never know. You'll never know until you actually try it. And you know, most of us, we gather our resolve. We think, oh, this is the only time in my life. This is so rare. I want to just ride this wave for as long as possible, you know. And at some point, you got to kick out of the wave. You got barreled for a while, and now it's going to close out. You better kick out. Slater kicks out at Cloud Break. You know, you think he's riding these multiple barrels on this one wave. It's just unbelievable what he did. And he finally comes out of one, and you just think, oh man, go for another, Kelly, go for another. No, he kicks out. He realizes he's closing out. You kick out, get out, so you don't get caught inside and get hammered. You know, and you got to realize that. And you got to realize that what did you catch the first wave of the set? Or did you catch the last wave? And you're thinking in your mind, are there other waves coming in, set waves coming in? Because if there are, you might get caught inside. And in case of cloud break, you're going to get pulled into the reef and you're going to get cut to pieces. It's very dangerous. Very dangerous. So, you know, kick out, get out of the wave while the getting's good. You got your great barrel, right? And scratch out there and get outside so you don't get caught inside by the set waves. And, be smart. Be smart. Live to serve another day. You know, don't get caught inside and get pounded. Whereas if you try to keep going with it, eventually your panic will set in and you're going to get emotionally pounded by by your resistance. But your continuity fear is going to beat you up. Really beat you up. So you have to have this, you have to be a great spiritual surfer. You really got to understand, okay, what's at play here? It's not just this wave. It's the reverberation, just the backlash that's coming in. There's set waves coming in. I got to make sure that I can get out in that channel and get around. You know, it's not all about the ride. It's about getting back out without getting caught inside also. So it's not all about the breakthrough. It's about the backlash too and how to manage that backlash properly so you can gather resolve again quite soon and catch another great wave. And this wave is going to be even better. So it's about all of that. If you want to be successful, of course, most don't want to succeed yet because they think maybe my next life will be better. Don't count on it. Don't count on it. Doesn't tend to go that way. I mean, what I've seen is it gets worse. Gets worse and until you just become, you know, unmanageable, arrogant brat. You know, you get so frustrated, you just want everything to go the way you want it to go. And when it doesn't, you just can't handle it anymore. So it gets worse. So, you know, consider being successful and consider tuning into how to be successful. And do not count on death. Fame, fortune, I had it all. I had fame, I had fortune, I had influence, I had historic impact, and I had death. None of that did it for me. It got worse. It got much worse. In fact, it got terrible. I had a fortunate birth here, everything going for me. It got terrible. So do not count on any creatureness to do anything but make it more and more terrible for you. You need to become this very wise being, you know, spiritual being on the spiritual path, seeing this practice like this and how it works for you, how it smooths it out, how it helps you gather your resolve more and more and more and more and more and more and more. Okay, I have to gather my resolve to do these videos. I've been doing videos virtually every day for years, right? I have to gather my resolve. It doesn't happen unless I gather my resolve. So the ability to do these videos is because I'm practicing properly and for no other reason. All right. And I have to gather my resolve to get up in the morning and go to work if there is any work, which work is suddenly dried up. That's a problem. So I have to gather my resolve for prayer. You know, yeah. Jesus Christ, Anandamayama, Holy Spirit, Longchenpa, Ramana, 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 Ramana. Try that one for a powerful, powerful affirmation. Jesus Christ, Anandamayama, Holy Spirit, Longchenpa, Ramana, 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 Ramana. Jesus Christ, Anandamaya Ma, Holy Spirit, Longchenpa, Ramana, 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 Ramana. When you're in trouble, try that prayer. Just invoke them, invoke them, invoke them. Don't ask them for anything, just invoke their presence. Jesus Christ, Anandamaya Ma, Holy Spirit, Longchenpa, Ramana, 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 Ramana. Just invoke their presence. That's it. Don't ask them for anything. Don't define anything. Just invoke their presence. Gather your resolve, you know, to invoke their presence. Jesus Christ, Ananda Mayama, Holy Spirit, Longchenpa, Ramana, 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 Ramana. And with that, I have to get my resolve to focus on the day that is to come. It's late now. Okay, very great. Jesus Christ, Ananda Mayama, Holy Spirit, Longchenpa, Ramana, 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 Ramana. Wow.